بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Welcome to this week's episode of Reflections of Islam. I'm your host Abdur Raheem McCarthy, and in today's episode we're going to be talking about reflections on some of the characteristics of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And when we look at the importance of this topic, we see that a lot of the misconceptions that the non-Muslims or those who fight Islam, that they spread about Islam, is about the misconceptions and the lies that they spread about our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And it's important when we look through the seerah that we see that this is the game that the enemies of Islam, they played from the beginning of Islam as well. When the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he was in Mecca, they accused him of being a sha'ir, being somebody who was a poet or a magician, and they called him a liar and other things, even though he was known before that to them as al-Amin. He was known as a sadiq al-Amin, as the one who was truthful, as the one who was truthful and trustworthy. And even with this, they accused him of lying after he came to them with Islam. So when we focus on these beautiful characteristics of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, anybody who sees the life of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, no doubt that he will love him. And this will make those who are the enemies of Islam come, inshallah, to those who love our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and perhaps even enter into Islam. And if you look at Michael Hart in his famous book, when he talked about the 100 most influential men in the history of mankind, even though he admitted it, he said, "I didn't really want to do it as a Christian," but he admitted, number one, that the most influential man in the history of mankind was our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, because there's no man and all of mankind who had that type of impact on his people. And you'll see this impact until the day we live in, how it has affected so many millions of lives. At the same time, our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was not just a religious leader, he was also the judge, the general of the army. Everything you can think of at that time, he was the imam of the masjid, the khatib of the masjid. Everything you can think about at that time, he was the counselor that people will go to. All of this shows you the status and the greatness of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In today's episode, we're going to look into some of the characteristics of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. For example, the issue of akhlaq, of having good behavior, good morals and good manners. You'll see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Aisha said radiyallahu anha, kana khuluquhu al-Qur'an, that his morals or his behavior, that it was that of the Qur'an. And if you look, what are the manners that the Qur'an calls to? When you look into the Qur'an, you'll see that the Qur'an, it calls to being patient when people harm you in certain ways, that you are patient. It calls to patience. It calls to not oppressing people. It calls to being just. It calls to giving people their rights. It calls to being forgiving and forgiving people when they have done something to you. Also, the Quran, it calls to being truthful and not lying. And the list goes on and on. You'll see that these are some of the things, the manners that the Quran calls to, and these were the manners of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as Aisha said, kana khuluquhu al-Quran. Also, when you look into the sunnah of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the hadith he mentioned showing the importance of akhlaq in Islam, you'll see, first of all, through the sunnah, the implementation. It wasn't something that he just said about the akhlaq. You'll see the implementation, as we're going to see all through this episode, the implementation of these manners, of these morals in his life, alayhi salatu wasalam. And you'll see this in his sunnah, in his seerah. And then you'll see the statements where he encouraged his ummah and told them about the importance of the akhlaq, he said alayhi salatu wasalam that ma min shay athqal fil mizan min husn al khuluq, that there's nothing that will be heavier in the scale, meaning the scale of deeds. Because as you know, on the day of judgment, we will have a scale with two sides, a real scale. It will be a real scale that will have our good deeds on one side and our bad deeds on the other side, to see which one is heavier, to see where we'll be going, to the heavens or to the hellfire. May Allah protect us all from the hellfire. And he said, alayhi salatu wasalam, the heaviest thing in this scale on the day of judgment will be good manners. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahumma salli wa sallim wa barak ala nabiyyina Muhammad. Also in another hadith, you'll see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, ala ukhbirukum, should I not tell you with the best of you and those who will be closest to me in manzila on the day of judgment? And he said, hasanukum akhlaqa, the best of you in manners. And he also said, alayhi salatu wasalam, in another hadith, that the best of you is the best of you in manners. And another hadith, alayhi salatu wasalam, the hadith of Anas, the famous hadith, and Anas ibn Malik radiyallahu an, he was the khadim, the servant of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. When our beloved Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam went to Medina, he migrated to Medina, Anas ibn Malik, his mother radiyallahu anha, she came with her son Anas. He was 10 years old at the time. And she said, I want him to serve you. And he as a servant, and he was with the Prophet ﷺ in Medina for 10 years as his servant. And he said during this time that I never heard him say uff. And uff, as it came in the Quran, it's a word that has a type of disrespect, but it's the lightest type of word. I mean, it's not a severe word like a curse word, but, and it came in the Quran, to not say to your parents uff, be out of having respect for your parents and be respectful to your parents, that you cannot say to them uff. And uff, and you know, now when if he says go do this, your mother says go do this, or your father says go do this, they say uff, oh, like we say, you know, oh, uff. It's not something that's a heavy word, but you can't even say this. And this shows you about the beauty of the Quran, when it shows us how we must be respectful to our parents. And Anas ibn Malik, and pay attention, he's the khadim, the servant of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 10 years, and he said, I never even heard from him say uff to me, alayhi salatu wasalam. Allahumma salli wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad. And another hadith of Anas also, radiallahu anhu, that he had sent him one time to get something for him or do something for him. And when he sent him, he's a young boy. And pay attention, he was 10, maybe he was 13, 15 during this hadith, Allahu alam. But this was during the time in Medina. The Prophet ﷺ sent him. He was still a young boy at the time. And when he sent him to do something, Anas ibn Malik, radiallahu anhu, he was a young boy. He saw the other young boys playing in the street. So he stopped to watch them. And that's something normal for all boys to do. And it's something we must realize as fathers as well, and as mothers as well, that our children, and when we send them to do something, this could happen to them as well. So what will we do? Think about that. Now you sent your son, or you sent your servant to go to the store, for example, and buy something for you, or to get something for you and come right back. And you're waiting in the house. You're waiting in the house, he doesn't come back. And you go outside and you find him playing in the street with the other kids. What would you do? We take him, we smack him probably. We get upset. What are you doing? Or we start screaming at him. What are you doing? And look at how our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what he did. He went up behind him. He put his hands on his shoulder, sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and radiallahu an. He put his hands on his shoulder and he turned around. He saw him, what? How was he looking? Very angry. His face had turned red. Astaghfirullah. Not our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. That's our faces. Our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had put his hands on his shoulders and he looked at him and he was smiling. He said, didn't I not send you to do something? And he said, yes, you did. So he told him to go do it then. He wasn't upset, he wasn't angry. So we see the beauty of how the Prophet ﷺ acted in his akhlaq. And because of the importance of akhlaq in manners and morals in Islam, it came in the hadith, as we mentioned in some of the past episodes, where the Prophet ﷺ said, إِنَّمَا بُعِثْتُ لِأُتِمِّ مَكَارِمَ الْأَخْلَاقِ, that verily he was sent, one of the things he was sent with the Quran, and one of the things he was sent with for tawheed and for the guidance of mankind, one of the things he was sent for was to perfect the akhlaq, to perfect the manners and the morals of people, alayhi salatu wasalam. So we gain from this the importance of good manners in Islam, and the Prophet was not somebody who called to good manners, he was somebody who implemented it in his life as well, alayhi salatu wasalam. And also, if you were to look at his karam, his generosity, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, that, and most people who are kings or rulers, you'll find that their main goal is to fill up their treasure chest of gold and all this. Their main goal is to fill up their bank accounts, to fill up, you know, to have all the gold and the money that they can. So you'll see that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was somebody who died and he had nothing. He left nothing in his dunya whatsoever. Just some of his battle armor is the only thing that he left behind him. And he also was somebody that used to give from his karam, from his generosity, as it came in the hadith, that he would give so much that he would give like a person who was not even scared of being poor, because he used to always give and give and give, alayhi salatu wasalam. And we will continue, inshallah, talking about the beautiful characteristics of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam. But after this short break, so stay tuned, and we'll be right back, inshallah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Welcome back to this week's episode of Reflections of Islam. And we've been talking in this week's episode about some of the beautiful characteristics of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and how we can benefit from his manners and his morals, and also how this can reflect the beauty of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to the non-Muslims as well. The non-Muslims who have so many misconceptions about our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And the third thing we can point out in his seerah when we talk about him alayhi salatu wasalam is his zuhud in this dunya. The fact that he was not attached, his heart was not attached to this dunya, and he was not somebody who strove for the worldly affairs of this life. When you look, as we mentioned before the break, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that he died, he had left nothing behind except for some armor and things like that, basic things. He didn't leave anything of the wealth of this dunya behind with him. Also, he was somebody who gave so much out of his generosity. He was not like the kings who want to gather all they could from the riches of this world. Also, when you look in his seerah alayhi salatu wasalam, it was mentioned that his clothes were very, very basic, and he would just wear that which was available. Also, that he would sleep on hasir. And hasir, it's a type of wood almost like the bamboo sticks tied together very tightly. And you still have it in a lot of Arab countries. You'll see now that the Prophet said he used to sleep on this, and it would leave an impression on his side, because he would sleep on his side, alayhi salatu wasalam. So you'll see now that some of the companions were affected. And how can he be our beloved Prophet? He can be the one we follow. He's our leader. He's everything to us. And he sleeps on a bed like this that leaves impressions on his side. And they want to bring him a nicer bed, but he wasn't really concerned about that, alayhi salatu wasalam. He spent the greater portion of the night praying. Spent a lot of the night praying anyway, so it wasn't like, and he knew that this dunya was just a short amount of time, and that he would be moving on. And this is the reality of this life that we live in, that unfortunately a lot of us, our hearts are so attached to it, we act like we're going to be here forever. And also, when you look at his tawadu, alayhi salatu wasalam, when you look at his, how humble he was, alayhi salatu wasalam, you'll see how great of a man he was, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. When you see the story, or you're looking at the hadith, that he was never called to any type of ta'am. Nobody invited him for food except that he would go. Even one time, when one of the Jews invited him over, and you got to imagine now, you're inviting over somebody who is the ruler of the country, who is the general of the army, who is the judge. He's everything in Medina. And this Yehudi, this Jew, invites him over, and he doesn't give him something nice to eat. He gives him dry bread. And because of his tawadu alayhi salatu wasalam, because he's so humble, he didn't even say anything, ate this dry bread with this Jewish man, and he did not say anything to him. Also, the khadam, the servants, the young children, they would come up to him, they would grab him by his hand, and they would explain to him their problems. Now, this is the ruler of the country, and he would sit there and listen to them and pay attention to them and give them much respect. And this affected them. And can you imagine now, if a child would come up to him and complain, or a servant will come up and complain about how he's being treated, what would the ruler say to him today? Kid, get out of here. We don't have time to listen to that. I have more important things to do. But our beloved Prophet ﷺ, he would stop and he would listen to them, and he would try to help them in their problems as well. Also, if you look at how humble he was when he was on his deathbed, alayhi salatu wasalam, he made sure that the Muslims know who he is, alayhi salatu wasalam, and what his message is really about. His message is to call to tawheed, to worship Allah as one and not join any partners with him, and to stay away from shirk. He said when he was on his deathbed, alayhi salatu wasalam, لا تطروني كما أطرط النصارى عيسى بن مريم. Do not over-exaggerate in praising me as the Christians over-exaggerated in praising Isa, Jesus, the son of Maryam, the son of Mary. He said, فَإِنَّمَا أَنَا عَبْدٌ فَقُلْ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ وَرَسُولُهُ. He said, verily I am a servant, so say the servant of Allah and his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And from his beautiful characteristics, alayhi salatu wa sallam, was the fact that he would never seek revenge for himself. As it came in the hadith, مَنْ تَقَمْ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ سَلَّلَهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِنَفْسِهِ قَطْ. Then he never sought revenge, alayhi salatu wa sallam. He never sought revenge for himself. But if something was done that was haram, then he would become angry for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And also when you look through his seerah, through the implementation of not seeking revenge for himself, you'll see it in the Fath of Mecca, and also at the beginning of Islam, in the war of Badr, in the battle of Badr, when the Muslims were victorious, and they killed 70 of the mushrikeen, of those of Quraysh, and also they had 70 prisoners of war. So the Muslims differed, what should they do? And the Prophet ﷺ, because he has tawadu, he's a humble person, he didn't say, my decision is this, and this is it. He went and asked his companions. It's the first time, it's a new Muslim state, and it's only been established for a short amount of time now, and now they've had a major battle, a major war, and they have prisoners of war. What should they do? He didn't just say, he went to his companions, and his most beloved companions to him were Abu Bakr and Umar, radiallahu anhuma, and he asked them, what do you think we should do? His opinion, alayhi salatu wasalam, what he felt is that they should have the prisoners of war and give them back to Quraysh, but for a ransom. And he said they were hoping to gain from this, and they were going to benefit from the money, obviously, but the main goal is not the money, it's actually a da'wah tool. When they see that we're giving the prisoners of war back, that what we want from you, we don't want to kill you as Muslims, we want the good for you, and the good for you is in Islam, and we want to invite you to Islam. So this was the main goal of them wanting to give the prisoners of war back. As for Umar ibn al-Khattab, radiallahu anh, he said, no way. He said, my idea is that we kill all of them. We execute all 70 of them, and we send a message, not just to Quraysh. We send a message to all of the Arabs around the Arab Peninsula that we are for real. The Muslim state has been established, and we are for real. And this is a message to them to watch out. So you'll see that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he had the same opinion of Abu Bakr to what? To give them back to Quraysh for this ransom. And we benefit so much from the story of the prisoner of war in Badr. Some of the main things that we can benefit is that Abu Bakr and Umar, radiallahu anhuma, the fact that they differed in their opinion, that did not lead them to have ikhtilaf, to differ between them and for their hearts to be separated and for them to have a problem against one another. You'll see that even though they differed, their hearts were still as one, and they didn't have anything bad in their hearts against their Muslim brother. Also, it shows us that Islam is the deen, is the religion of rahmah, the religion of mercy, and it shows us as well the importance of knowing how to deal with the non-Muslims, because this is something that we do, not just at the time of war, even at the time of peace, you'll see that a Muslim must know how to deal with non-Muslims. In the world we live in today, even though the Muslims, they are a big percentage of the population in the world, but there's more people in the world who are not Muslims, so we must know how to deal with them in the proper light as our brothers in humanity. We must know how to deal with them because we are all human beings at the end of the day, even though we differ in our religion. And from the beautiful things of the characteristics of our Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is his rif, how gentle he was. He was a very gentle man, alayhi salatu wasalam, when it came to dealing with people. And you'll see this in the several stories where the A'rab, the Bedouins, would come to him and they would raise their voice to him. And they wouldn't say, Ya Rasulullah, O Prophet of Allah, as his companions would. They would say, Ya Muhammad, with a very deep voice. And he was very gentle with them. Also, when they would come and pull, in the story when they came and pulled on his camel, on the muzzle of his camel, as he was walking, alayhi salatu wasalam. So these people, because they're very rough people in their nature, they were very disrespectful to the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And he was very gentle in how he dealt with him also, alayhi salatu wasalam. Also, you'll see the treatment of the children in Islam and how he dealt with children. This also shows the gentle side of our beloved Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Also, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam is a very forgiving person. And you'll see this in the story of Badr that we saw before, and also, as I mentioned, in the Fath of Mecca, when the Muslims conquered Mecca. And I want you to remember that the people of Quraysh, They are the people who told and spread lies about the Prophet ﷺ while he was in Mecca. They tortured his companions. They fought Islam to the best of their ability during the time of Mecca, during the time of Medina. And what year was the Fatah Mecca? The conquering of Mecca was in the 8th year of Hijrah. So if you do the math, that's 13 and 8, that's 21 years of fighting Islam. These people have been fighting Islam, they've been fighting the Prophet ﷺ, they've been slandering him for 21 years. And when he came in to Mecca, he told them that whoever enters his house, that he is safe, and that whoever enters the house of Abu Sufyan, that he is safe, and whoever enters the Masjid al-Haram in Mecca also, that he is safe. And when he went to them in Mecca, when he was there with them in Mecca, and they're around the Kaaba, he asked them, what do you think I'm going to do with you? And then at the end he said that I have forgiven all of you. So he was a very forgiving person, alayhi salatu wassalam. Also, when you look at his sabr, he was also a very patient person, alayhi salatu wassalam. As it came in the story of his trip to Al-Ta'if, when the Prophet ﷺ went to Ta'if in the south of Mecca, that they ordered their children, he went to call them to Islam, he's calling them to khair, they ordered their children to throw rocks at him, alayhi salatu wassalam, until blood came down his body, alayhi salatu wassalam, and filled his sandals. And he was patient. When the angel of the mountain said, would you like me to close the mountains on them? And he crushing and destroying all of them, he was patient and he said, perhaps somebody will come from their offspring who worships Allah and does not join any partners with him. So he was very patient, alayhi salatu wassalam. Also, if you look at the husband and how he was, as it came in the hadith, kana fi khidmati ahlihi, that he was in the service of his ahl, meaning his wives and his family, and he was in their service. وَإِذَا أُذِنَ لِلصَّلَاةِ, and if it was called to prayer, that it was like he didn't even know us. He would get up and prepare for salat immediately when he heard the adhan, the call to prayer. But if you look at his life as a husband, inshallah, we'll talk a little bit more about that, perhaps in the coming episodes, inshallah ta'ala. Also, if you look at his bravery, alayhi salatu wasalam, our beloved Prophet was a very brave man. And all people, they love people who are brave. Our Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasalam, as it came in the hadith in Bukhari and Muslim, as that he kind of asja'a nas, that he was the bravest of all people. And when the fighting got difficult, that they would surround themselves with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because he was fierce also on the battlefield. And also you'll see in his seerah alayhi salatu wasalam, that he was a just man, and he was somebody who stood for justice, as it came in the hadith, wallahi, lo sariqat Fatima bint Muhammad la qata'tu yadaha. One of them was trying to intercede, so he would not cut off the hand of this makhzumiyyah. And he said, so we're not cut off the hand of one of the women. So he said that if the daughter, Fatima, the daughter of Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, were to have stolen, I would have cut off her hand. And obviously she would not steal, because he was somebody who followed justice. And it wasn't because you know somebody, you're going to get off. And the list goes on and on. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, in human rights, you'll see that he was, alayhi salatu wasalam, somebody who stood for human rights. And somebody, as it came in the story of Hilf al-Fudul in the Seerah, and also in the story of Abu Jahl, when he stole the man's camels, and the Prophet ﷺ went to him and requested that he give his camels back, because he was somebody who stood for human rights and for justice. And also he was the Nabi of Rahmah, as one of his names is, the Nabi of mercy. And as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, وَمَا أَرْسَلْنَاكَ إِلَّا رَحْمَةً لِلْعَالَمِينَ, and we have not sent you except for a mercy to mankind. So he was the prophet and the messenger of Rahmah alayhi salatu wasalam. That's all the time we have for this week's episode. And until next week, الله أعلم وصلى الله وسلم وبارك على نبينا محمد والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Mm-hmm.